Hi students, very good evening. I hope you have listened to my previous lecture on Bakhtin's theory and the concepts of polyphony especially. So after that I will start now regarding another, that is dialogism, that is the concept of Bakhtin. But before going to this what you call dialogism, we have to see what is monologism. So let us see what is monologism. I will share my presentation now. Yeah, here it is. I hope you can see this. Monologism, actually according to Bakhtin, this Dostoevsky is having a dialogism in his work. And this dialogical principle, according to Bakhtin, is in contradiction to monologism, which is nothing but single thought or single discourse, which is also termed as homophony, a single voice. This is nothing but monarchy, okay, or monotheism, or monoculture. Monoculture is the word of these days, contemporary days. So you know what is monarchy. So only the word of one person or one belief or one tradition prevails. See, during the colonialism, what happened? The Europeans were very monologistic because of that. They felt that their tradition is the only great tradition. They could not accept other traditions, other cultures, other practices. So that is why what happened? They have gone to colonize most of the parts of the world, and they have tried to establish their power. So actually, monologism, monotheism, monoculture, no monarchy, these are nothing but giving preference to one thing. That is, actually, preferring one thing means not accepting the other. So for Bakhtin, as I told you, Bakhtin wrote during the repressive Stalinistic regime, and Stalin was a hardcore dictator, and he believed in his consciousness or in his idea or in his perspective, and that is why people who were raising voice against Stalin were not allowed to live, and even Bakhtin was forced to exile. So this always, you know, he writing in such kind of repressive conditions, perhaps Bakhtin felt the need of dialogism very much, because what was prevailing around him is monologism, that is monarch. Stalin is the monarch, and only he believes in his perspective. If, you know, if this when this monologistic view becomes the view of the leader of a certain group, or the head of a certain group or a country or a family, etc., naturally he believes that the dictator, he or she believes that only his view should prevail and other voices are not at all allowed. Other voices might be speaking of other ideologies, other perspectives, yet they don't want to listen. And they believe that theirs is the one transcendental perspective or consciousness, and it integrates the entire field and thus integrates all the significant practices, ideologies, values, and desires that are deemed significant. They think that they are significant, but they won't be put to the test to prove that whether they are really significant or not. Anything irrelevant to this perspective is deemed superfluous or irrelevant in general. So monologistic view of the world will not allow the other ideas, the other consciousness, or will not believe in dialogue also. They themselves will fix everything. So this is monologistic. And then further, Bhaktin says, a monological world is made up of objects integrated through a single consciousness. Oh, it is a single consciousness, one perspective. This is the perspective of the monarch. Okay? Since other subjects have value only in relation to the transcendent perspective. So other, subjects, other people. See, in monarchy, it is the existence of king that is very much important. Even in war, if you take, when wars take place, if the king is dead, the entire empire is conquered. And for making the king alive or keeping the king alive, thousands and lakhs of soldiers may die. And those wars in the name of imperialism or expansion of their nation's borders, etc., whether it is real, useful or not, no one can question. So that is why when we have monarchy, wars were very rampant. And of course, you have the example of European colonialism. So they of course have the monarchy type of governments only. So here the monological world, thinks that all others are existing only because of them. And all others are objects. Okay. They are not considered as living subjects. They don't have their own voice. And they are not recognized as another consciousness. Only monologic means what? Only one consciousness, one word, one religion, one tradition, one culture. That is what. So that is what exists. They won't believe in another consciousness. And they don't think that others have rights. See how in colonialism also you can very much increase this. They colonials, the master felt that only white is the master. Black or brown are not the masters. And that is why they were not even considered as humans, blacks. They were mentioned as apes. So the belief in the white, single color, okay, and race, white race, is what made them to look down the entire world, other world. So people are not only white on the earth, yet they made themselves superior, okay, and they actually, this is what, if people start believing in the monological world or monological perspective of the world or culture or tradition, they cannot accept the existence of other cultures, other traditions or even other races. This is what Bhaktin is also telling, that they will be reduced to the status of objects. We are objectified. And then monologism is taken to close down the world it represents by pretending to be the ultimate world. So whatever dominant race or the dominant leader believes is the only word, ultimate word, commandment, like commandments or degrees. And in what happens in monologism, truth constructed abstractly and systematically from the dominant perspective is allowed to remove the rights of consciousness. So others' rights of consciousness are never accepted or considered. Each subject's ability to produce autonomous meaning is denied. So the monologism will not encourage what you call as live and let live policy, in the sense considers that one is the superior and all others are for his existence only, and to follow his word only. They should not have their own consciousness, but they should follow the consciousness of the master. And qualitative difference is rendered quantitative. This performs a kind of discursive death of the other, who is unheard and recognized. In the literary theory, the concept of the other, othering, the process of othering, master, slave, I used to tell you in the binaries that we have, only the first thing is valorized and the second is not at all considered. The master is superior and the slave has no right at all. The history of African-American slaves or African slaves, etc., who actually have no right to live also. They won't live, or they can't live for themselves, but they have to live for the master. This is what. So they actually construct a truth and made everyone to accept that. And the other, who are being ruled will be considered as mere objects existing for the sake of the master. So here he says that it is like a death for the other, and their voice are not heard, unheard, and they are not recognized, and their being itself is not, and they are in a state of non-being, as if they are not at all existing. Okay, the monological word gravitates towards itself and its referential object. So this idea of tautological closure of dominant discourse is also found in Negri, Marcus, Baudrillard and Barthes. Okay, the same idea, how monological world creates or makes the unheard, unrecognized non-beings, okay, who are objectified. This is believed by other philosophers also. And here Bakhtin gives us a kind of novel, because he feels that Dostoevsky's dialogical principle is very important, and all Dostoevsky's novels are based on the dialogical principle. You will find polyphony in his novels or in his work. So, in contrast to such kind of works like Dostoevsky's, which are having dialogism or polyphony, what happens in a monological novel? He says characters exist solely to transmit the author's ideology, and the author represents only their own idea, not anyone else's. So, in the monological novel, there won't be any polyphony. Maybe perhaps it is like homophony, as you say, monological. Okay. And because the whole text, though we have characters, different characters, all the characters will be transmitting the ideology of the author only, and they will be representing the author's idea, not any other character's idea. So any differences between characters occur as if within a single consciousness. Even though a little bit of differences are shown, they will be shown with a single consciousness only. Such novels, according to Bakhtin, tend to be featureless and flat, marked by a single tone. So they are not dialogic, they are monologic. Bhaktin is suspicious of authorial intent. You know, this is why we also discussed in the class, if we are examining or evaluating a work of literature, okay, from the point of view of authorial intent or author's intention, it will limit the scope of the text, scope of the analysis of the text. So that is why we say the post-structuralist idea of detaching the text from the author, or that is there even in the new criticism or practical criticism, though it was given some other concepts are emphasized in those, unlike post-structuralism. So the Bhaktin is suspicious of authorial intent, and as it often involves a failure to respect the autonomy of the other's voice. So he says that, you know, author is like a dictator. Author's intention is like the dictatorship. Of course, always suppresses the other voices. It won't give autonomy. It won't give any freedom. So this monological novel, of course, is not discursive. And he feels that what you get out of that is not different perspectives of this world, because by nature, the world is not, monoculture, as I told you, because in nature itself, we have dialogism. That is what Bhaktin's philosophy says that. And he also said one thing, that though we are unique, of course, in nature, we live in coordination with other objects, things in the nature. So the nature or this world or the language also basically are dialogic. But monarchies or monological literature, etc., are suppressing this dialogism that is inherently there in the nature or even in language. So this is what monologism is for Bhaktin, and he feels that monological world or monologism leads to a kind of repressive government, and it treats others as objects whose existence is not recognized at all, whose voices are not heard, or who are not let to speak also, like the subaltern. So this is how Bhaktin says that a monological literature or monological world is in opposition to dialogical world. So dialogical principle, especially for literature, as literature students, we should say take that only. So Bhaktin thinks that Dostoevsky's dialogical principle is contradicted, okay, in contradiction to the monological literature or monologism. So now let us see what is dialogism. Though it is a little bit difficult to explain, dialogism, on the most basic level, it refers to the fact that the various languages that stratify any single language or in dialogue with one another. So what Bhaktin means here? It refers to the fact that the various languages that stratify any single language. So here be keen in listening, and Bhaktin is not talking about different languages like English, Hindi, Urdu, Telugu, like that, but he is talking about various languages that stratify any single language, and they are in dialogue with one another, and Bhaktin calls this the primordial dialogism of discourse, whereby all discourse has a dialogic orientation. So that is what I was telling previously, that inherently there is dialogism in this world, in a language, in nature, in life, in the creation itself there is dialogism, but this dialogism is not accepted. So he says, he calls this as the primordial, very ancient dialogism of discourse. So that is why he says all discourse has this dialogic orientation. We might illustrate this using the following example, like the language of religious discourse does not exist in a state of ideological and linguistic neutrality. On the contrary, such discourse might act as a rejoinder or reply to elements of political discourse. See, we have in a society the language of religious discourse. This will not exist in a state of ideological and linguistic neutrality. On the contrary, such discourse might act as a rejoinder or reply to the elements of political discourse. If you take a language, or if you take discourse, religious discourse and political discourses are different. The political discourse might encourage loyalty to the state and adherence to the material ambitions, whereas the religious discourse might attempt to displace those loyalties with the pursuit of spiritual goals. So religion is different, politics is different. So in a language, this discourse of religion and the other discourse of politics are in contradiction. And even a work of art does not come Minerva-like, fully formed from the brain of its author, speaking a single monologic language. It is a response, a rejoinder to other works, to certain traditions, and it situates itself within a current of intersecting dialogues. Oh, so here Bhaktin is stating that a work of art is also not a single, will not use a single monologic language. It will have a response, it will have a rejoinder, and it will have some rejoinder with other works, and to other works, to other traditions, and it of course gives us some intersecting dialogues. Its relation to other works of art and to other languages, that is literary and non-literary, is dialogic. You know, literary languages and non-literary language, a work of art will be always in a dialogue with other forms. And further, he gives a good, more profound example. He explains that there is no direct, unmediated relation between a word and its object. So, actually, when a word is entering into the world, of course, it will be entering into an elastic atmosphere. So, the world into which the word is entering is having much elasticity. It is not fixed. But once uttered, the word may mean many things. Not exactly any, we cannot fix any single meaning to any word. No living word relates to its object in a singular way. So perhaps because of this nature of words only, misunderstandings also occur. I know these misunderstandings will become even more when you are texting using SMS languages. Okay, so it depends upon many instances. Say for example, if I text you like "How are you?" You know, if it is between two friends, if I text like "How are you?" So it may be taken. If you it depends upon your mood or your situation in which you were involved at the time when you receive my message. Okay, so there is a there might be many chances of what you call responding in many ways. So for example, you can, you know, for "How are you?" there is no any single answer like "fine," "good," "great," "oh, doing great job," etc., etc. So it depends upon your emotion also, your situation also, and depending upon that, of course, it varies. So it is to say that there is a dialogism. There is no single perspective. There is no monologic answer. In its path toward the object, the word encounters, according to Bakhtin, the fundamental and richly varied opposition of other aligned words about the same subjects. So if you leave other factors, you know, as we have seen the functions of language and the factors of language in linguistics and poetics, wherein of course a single word or a single verbal message will function, okay, say not though not all six, but it may be having at the most two or three, so not single. There itself you can understand that it is dialogic, and of course Bhaktina is also telling like that. So when a word is entering into the world, it may meet some aligned words about the same subject which are opposite in meaning. Okay, and any concrete discourse, according to Bakhtin, finds the object at which it was directed already, as it were, overlain with the qualifications, open to dispute, charged with value, already enveloped in an obscuring mist, or on the contrary, by the light of alien words that have already been spoken about it. So when you enter into a discourse, actually, or any concrete discourse, according to Bakhtin, any discourse that is directed towards any object, already as it were overlain with qualifications, sometimes it may open dispute, it might be charged with value, or it might have already enveloped in some kind of obscuring mist, or on the contrary, by the light of alien words that have already been spoken about it. So once the discourse is out, we cannot restrict the meaning because it gets influenced by many, many things. It is entangled, shot through with shared thoughts, point of view, alien value judgment, and accents. So once the discourse begins, there is every possibility that it will get influenced by shared thoughts, points of view, alien value judgment, and accents. The word directed towards its object enters a dialogically agitated and tension-filled environment. This is what he says in the discourse in the novel. It cannot fail to become an active participant in social dialogue. The way in which the word conceives its object is complicated by a dialogic interaction within the object between various aspects of its socio-verbal intelligibility. So it depends when a word is released, the meaning, the reception, or the development of certain discourse depends upon the socio-verbal intelligibility. So, of course, words are very tricky. Sometimes they bring many problems also. This is what Bakhtin believes, because what, why it happens? Because a word is not having any single aspect of meaning. The world that the word enters is very much dialogic. It will get influenced by many. Okay. Dialogism, in contrast, recognizes the multiplicity of perspectives and voices. See, in contradiction to the monologism, Bakhtin says that it recognizes the multiplicity of perspectives and voices. It is also referred to as double-voiced or multi-voiced. So, dialogism is considered as double-voiced or multi-voiced. It is a principle which can become the main referent of a particular aesthetic field. So, dialogism is the principle behind any aesthetic field. Each character has their own final word, but it relates to and interacts with those of other characters. So, each character, of course, will have final word, but it will be interacting with the other characters and other discourses also. Discourse does not logically unfold, but rather interacts. And as in analytical philosophy, you know, it is not logically in unfolding something, but discourse, of course, interacts. This makes dialogical works a lot more objective and realistic than their monological counterparts. So, Bakhtin feels that dialogism makes the works more realistic and more objective than the monological works. Because dialogical works will not subordinate reality to the ideology of the other. So, reality, of course, is always dialogic. Reality is always not final, okay? So, in the dialogical works, reality will be very visible because they won't subordinate the reality to the ideology of the author. And then what Bakhtin says? He says that dialogism is, in contrast, recognizes the multiplicity of perspectives and voices. So, what dialogism will do in contradiction to monologism? It recognizes various perspectives, various voices. It is also referred to as, I am repeating the same slide. Yeah, a dialogical work constantly engages with and is informed by other works and voices and seeks to alter or inform it. So, always there is a dialogue. It draws on the history of past use and meanings associated with each word, phrase or genre. And everything is said in response to other statements and in anticipation of future statements also. That is what is dialogism. This style of language use is, according to Bakhtin, typical of everyday language use. Say, dialogical world, dialogical novels, of course, the language, how they use, is very much similar to the language use of everyday. Its use in novels accurately represents the reality of language use, how in reality we use language. You know, unlike the monological use of language, where you may get only one style of writing or one accent, only one accent, etc. In the dialogical works, you will get different accents, different styles. It is as if a discourse is going on in the society. So in the work itself, you will find the discourse. Those works are also called as discursive. And the dialogical world is always in an intense relationship with another's world. So it takes into consideration the another's world. And of course, it is not only because in a dialogue, we have the speaker and the listener. As we have seen in the speech circuit of Chazur and Jakobson's factors of a verbal message, okay, or speech event, etc. There is a speaker and listener. Perhaps the monological works will take into consideration the views of the speaker only, but not the listener. But a dialogical world, of course, always addresses to a listener and anticipates a response because it is designed to produce a response. It has a combative quality. Of course, a dialogical world has a combative quality and it is produced, designed to produce a response. It resists closure or unambiguous expression and fail to produce a whole. So there is no finality. This is what Bakhtin says. For life also, there is no finality. And for literature also, there is no finality. It is a consciousness lived constantly. According to him, dialogism is a consciousness that is lived constantly on the borders of other consciousnesses. So it recognizes the consciousness of others also. And then what he says, now Bakhtin tries to give that monological language is a corruption of an underlying dialogism. So already I told you that dialogism is inherent in life or in language or in the nature. So to make it monological is a corruption. And that is what Bakhtin says. All signifying practices, that is use of language and symbols, have an ultimately dialogical aim. So he says that all language signifying practices, they have dialogical aim. Human consciousness is not a unified entity. So he goes into the philosophy and then he says even in human consciousness also, you can see that it is not a unified entity, but rather he says is always conflict ridden between different consciousnesses. Naturally human consciousness, of course we have id, ego, superego, etc. Even in the psychological perspective also, it is not a unified entity. It is always conflict ridden between different consciousnesses. So our self-consciousness, consciousness of others, etc. So always there is a conflict within the humans. Indeed, a single consciousness separate from interaction with other consciousnesses is impossible. So we cannot separate a single consciousness. Okay. So always the consciousness is in interaction with the other consciousnesses and it is very impossible to separate them. And Bakhtin says that consciousness is always a product of responsive interactions and cannot exist in isolation. So human consciousness, he says, itself is a product of responsive interactions and it cannot exist in isolation. If you say that, what about, you know, Bhaktini is talking about here, if you say what about hermits or sages, etc., who just go away from the society and live a very lonely life, etc., and in with what they are in dialogue, okay, that is what we may get a question. So for that, of course, Bhaktin says that of course even they are in dialogue, so the human soul in dialogue with the divine soul or God, etc., or they are in dialogue with nature, or they are in dialogue with inner voices. So there is no reason to assume dialogism stops at the limits of the interhuman. So even if we are alone also, there may a process of dialogism go on. So that is true. The human consciousness is not monological according to Bhaktin. So when the human conscious is not monological, when nature itself is not monologic, how come language is considered as monologic, or how come literature is considered monologic? Is, you know, that is what do you say, validating one voice, okay? That is because this is a violation according to Bhaktin. This is a violation, and he says that interaction, you know, human dialogism will not stop at the limits of the interhuman. Don't think that only if two people are there, dialogism will happen. Even without that also, it happens. So nevertheless, language use can maximize this dialogical nature, or seeks to minimize or restrict it. So of course, language use will maximize or minimize or sometimes restrict this dialogism. It is, and again, Bhaktin is stating that dialogism means not simply different perspectives of the same world, but it involves the distribution of utterly incompatible elements within different perspectives of equal value. Bhaktin criticizes the view that disagreement means at least one of the people must be wrong. No. So this is more important, because we are the university students, and we should accept the presence of different ideologies. This is where dialogism. It is not simply different perspectives on the same world. And even if the different perspectives are there, it involves the distribution of utterly incompatible elements. They may not agree with each other, but not agreeing with each other, if in an agreement there is a disagreement, we should not consider that at least one of the people must be wrong, because many standpoints exist. Truth requires many incommensurable voices. Truth is not final. That is what, you know, this is actually the post-structuralist idea, wherein we believe, or it should be believed, that the definitions of good or bad, truth or false, etc., are not final. We cannot say that. Why? Because whatever is truth, whatever is good for our society may not be good for other society. Or whatever is bad for us may not be bad in other societies. So like that, he says that if the dialogism is not simply different perspectives, but it is involving the distribution of utterly incompatible elements. There is nothing wrong or right. And he says that many standpoints exist, and truth requires many incommensurable voices. Hence, it involves a world which is fundamentally irreducible to unity. We cannot reduce the world into a single unifying factor or unity. Actually, if you read feminist theories or post-colonial theories, you will understand this. Actually, post-colonial theories are based on accepting the presence of multiple voices or multiple perspectives or multiple traditions or many the existence of tradition. So according to the ideas of post-structuralism and of course according to Bakhtin, there is nothing that is wrong or right, that is imprisoned. The meanings of the words or actions are not imprisoned, and we cannot say this is right and this is wrong, etc. Because this is highly philosophical. And he says that dialogism means accepting the different voices or multiple voices. So it's actually it is based upon Bakhtin's philosophy. Okay. He, according to him, there is no single meaning to be found in the world, but a vast multitude of contesting meanings, plurality. There is no finality. There is always plurality. And truth is always established by aggressivity, engagement, commitment in a particular context. So, what is truth, etc., of course, is not, what is truth means we cannot give a single answer for that. Truth here is one thing, truth in America is one thing, or truth in some tribal communities is something, or truth in native tribes of America is one thing or the other thing. So like that, we have multitude of contesting meanings. So meaning is not single. So dialogism, this is what is the base of the post-structuralist idea also. And Bakhtin is putting dialogism and monologism contradicting to, in opposition to each other. And he believes in dialogism. And of course, he loathes monologism. And I told you all these ideas of Bakhtin were based or actually emanated due to the repressive Stalinistic regime in Russia. And of course, this is what is true about the other parts of the universe or the world also. You know, if unifying people send globalization, for example. Globalization is reducing the distance between nations, you know, spatially, and then bringing the world economy, etc. But now we are experiencing the adverse effects of globalization, okay? Because things change. We are unique beings. From the beginning itself, Bakhtin is stating that human beings are unique. And of course, our uniqueness, we should have it, whether we like it or not, we are unique only. And of course, he also says that we are always in coordinating with other things in the nature. So if we forget the other things, or if you try to unify, if you try to, develop in one aspect, of course, other aspects are neglected. So this is a globalization. If you read also why it is failing and a world economy, etc. People are different at different places and their needs are different. We cannot go after any one thing madly, or a single thing will not suit. Nowadays you have many medical these things also. People keep saying that this is good for health, this is good for health, etc. But they all may not suit you. We should be careful what suits us. We cannot generalize. Even medicine cannot be generalized. Okay, so this is how Bhaktin says that dialogism is the principle of this universe. And this, in nature there is dialogism, in language also there is dialogism. And that is why he thinks that the works of literature should be dialogic. And we have to analyze literature, works of literature from this perspective only. And he feels that Dostoevsky is one of the great writers who is very dialogic in his writings. So this is what I have to introduce, the concepts of Bhaktin. Later we'll be going into that essay, the discourse in the novel. And one more topic is there, that is Cornwallis and heteroglossia. Heteroglossia we'll be learning as part of the essay that is prescribed for your study. And Cornwallis, of course, after finishing the essay, I will explain. So before we go into the essay of Bhaktin, what you have to learn is that the world is very dialogic. And the words will not have their meaning in isolation. And the word, when it is coming out, is entering into a world of elasticity. And meaning is not a final. Okay. There is multiplicity of meanings. And of course, we have to accept that there is not one reality, but many realities. And this is actually highly philosophical world of accepting all ideas, accepting all ways of life, all traditions, all customs, all practices. Okay, even in linguistics also you have this perspective where you think that no language is inferior or superior. Language is language. Language is there for communication or other purposes, etc. So it is not devalidating or degrading one culture, one tradition, one language or one gender like that. So these ideas are highly philosophical, and also these are what are the basis behind the development of post-colonial theories and questioning the binaries of master, slave, okay, like that, or white, black, like that. So these are very logical and rational, highly rationalistic principles, which actually were questioning the exploitation of one human by the other also. So one race by the other also. So they, it's very important to know. And all his ideas that are based on this dialogical principle only. Okay, I'm closing my lecture here. Have a nice time.